Donald is a toughie to describe. He and his cheerleader groupies have the ability to fuse together and become a giant robot. Sure, it's probably just an excuse to include a giant mecha battle in the game, but who cares? It's a giant mecha battle! Giant mecha are friggin' awesome! You slash and kick your way to victory in this fight, breaking Charlie's guard and striking him down. You even have special attacks in this fight. How cool is that?
London Missile!
Charlie himself doesn't get much character development or any explanation as to how he can become this mecha, but again, just go with it. Lastly, I love this guy's voice. It's so exaggerated that it's practically laughable. But it's friggin' hilarious.
After this, I'm gonna touch you down! A butt-kicking day to you all!
Holy shit!
Yeah! I'm acting!
Destroy Buster!
Wait, what? Didn't you already include Destroy Man? Well, that was new Destroy Man. This is the older Destroy Man, and he's higher up for several reasons. He's still got the dark sense of humor that new Destroy Man has. He still has his giant penis laser. The fight plays out worlds better than new Destroy Man. And after you defeat him, he unleashes
Gun Nipples of Doom!
That death is friggin' awesome. What happens when you combine Dark Star and Henry from the first No More Heroes? Ryuji happens. This guy's got a Naginata that can produce a giant beam dragon from its hilt. It's as if you're finally facing Dark Star. This dragon is immensely dangerous, but then again, so is Travis. I mean, he can become a freaking tiger. Wait, hold up a sec. Tiger? Dragon? Oh, the symbolism. There's a mock sumo match on bikes before the actual fight. It plays like crap, but in the end, it's worth it because of the actual fight that follows it. The end of the fight even plays out like a stereotypical samurai fight, complete with Travis roaring in triumph.
Yeah!
Holly Summers is an underrated assassin from the first No More Heroes. The fight against her was excellent, pitting you in a sandy field full of pit traps against the missile-launching Holly Summers, and Holly Summers' personality is an incredible contrast to Travis's. Whereas Travis is hot-headed and brash, Holly is level-headed and intellectual.
Death is the only truth. You are still a mere bug.
Like a modern samurai, she's quick to take her own life after losing to Travis. In the end, Holly Summers was truly a human assassin. It really sucks that she had to blow herself up. Captain Vladimir is an odd choice for an assassin because he's not even aware of where or who he is. This boss battle raises up so many questions. How was he recruited into being an assassin? Did the UAA take advantage of Vladimir's insanity? How did he become insane in the first place? And why does he look like the Fury from Metal Gear Solid 3? Even in spite of these questions, the fight with Vladimir is arguably one of the best in No More Heroes 2. So much happens. Rocks fly around, lasers fall from the sky, and Vladimir shoots lasers from his helmet. As the battle rages on, the sun slowly begins to rise above the clouds, and as Vladimir loses health, the eerie cables on his back slowly begin to vanish, probably hinting at Vlad regaining his sanity. Personally, I think that Captain Vladimir is probably a ghost, especially considering the whole supernatural nature of the fight, and the fact that his body disappears after he dies. Just before Vladimir dies, he regains his sanity and realizes that he's been home all along.
Glory to the Soviet Union.
No More Heroes is infamous for its plot twists. Likely the most infamous twist happens when you're about to fight a boss called Let's Shake. Just when Travis and Let's Shake are about to fight, Henry falls from the sky, slashes Let's Shake in half, and makes it explode. So, if you don't fight Let's Shake, then why is it number 5? Let alone on this list at all? Well, you do fight Let's Shake. In No More Heroes 2, you're just about to enter a battle royale of assassins when something kills all of your opponents. Guess who? It's Let's Shake. Or Dr. Let's Shake now. This was such an ironic moment that I was literally in hysterics when I first saw it. We finally get to fight Let's Shake! Woo! So the fight begins, and it is awesome. Dr. Let's Shake charges up earthquakes at various speeds, and it's up to you to stay on a platform that isn't affected by the quake to dodge it. Then you chase down the good doctor and hack it to pieces. Awesome-tastic. I also guess I gotta mention this guy's speech pattern.
Efficient turn of events, do you agree? Question mark.
Have you ever seen a stage magician collapse a cage on a bird only to see the bird alive and well? Did you ever wonder if the first bird really died and the other bird was just an entirely different bird? Well, then you'll love this assassin. He's a magician that uses his magic tricks to kill people. His name is Harvey Moisevich Volodarsky. I couldn't even make that up if I tried. This battle is as much a magic show as it is an assassination. We see Harvey flip the screen, and he has a flashy yet incredibly easy to dodge one-hit KO move where he traps you in an exploding box. The battle's one drawback is that it's pathetically easy, but this original battle makes so much sense that it just may make me dread magic shows. By now, we all know that Mr. Sir Henry Motherfucker is among the most badass video game characters ever. He's a smooth-talking Irish guy who's the husband of Sylvia, who Travis has been wanting to get with for the whole game. He's got major skills with a beam katana, and his battle theme, known as We Are Finally Cowboys, is just mind-blowing. What else is there to say? He's goddamn Henry!
You're the protagonist. I'm just a cool, handsome foil who happens to be your twin brother.
One thing I love about boss battles is the build-up to them. Before you fight Rank 4 in No More Heroes 2, you have to endure a lengthy battle royale outside a supermarket. When I first played No More Heroes 2, I wondered what kind of boss could possibly be at the end of this. In a supermarket, no less. The answer is simple. An incredible one. Margaret Moonlight. At first glance, Margaret, like so many other bosses from No More Heroes 2, really doesn't have her backstory explained in detail. The cutscene before her is incredibly brief, but in this case, it doesn't have to be long at all. Like Harvey, Margaret's whole point as an assassin is pretty reasonable. She's a girl that dresses up as the Grim Reaper and hunts down people who she thinks are sinners. Don't believe me? Listen to her battle theme, Philistine. Oh yeah, not only is that song catchy, it perfectly explains Margaret's motives and her personality. Not to mention, Philistine insults Travis directly, showing that Travis has become something far from heroic. As for the fight itself, the atmosphere in this fight is endless. Since the end of your battle royale outside the supermarket, it's become night. The moon is full as you fight Margaret, the goddess of death. She's armed with scythes like the Grim Reaper, but with a twist. They have guns on their ends. She can even use the guns as sniper rifles to make things even rougher for you. How awesome is that? This whole fight is the very definition of memorable. Margaret's character is totally original, the fight is well fleshed out, and that boss theme is... well, I'll let Travis take it from here.
Catchy as hell.
Seriously, when the official soundtrack to No More Heroes 2 comes out, I'm making a music video. Like I even have to say her name. Alice Twilight is without a doubt the greatest boss in the No More Heroes series. Alice is basically a combination of Holly Summers and Henry in that she's remarkably honorable, yet an incredibly fierce fighter. Alice's mental state eerily mirrors Travis's at this point in the game. Both of them are questioning their existence as assassins and why they're killing all these people. Travis's experiences with Margaret and Captain Vladimir have already made him question the bloody system of assassination he's been trapped in, but it is Alice and her startling humanity that's the tipping point for Travis's career. There is endless atmosphere in this fight. The battle takes place at sundown, and the music is unlike anything we've heard in No More Heroes history. It's somber, eerie, and fitting of all the emotions running through Travis's and the player's minds. Of course, if symbolism isn't your thing, then you'll love the fight itself. Alice's weapon is awe-inspiring. She's armed with 5 robotic arms with beam katanas attached to them, as well as a robotic tail. The fight begins, and it becomes the single greatest sword fight in gaming history. 2 assassins, equal in strength and mind, dueling in front of the setting sun, dueling for what could be an empty cause. It's absolutely incredible. Alice, armed with 6 blades, has blindingly fast attacks that are stunning to watch. In the end, Travis kills Alice, and it drives him to his breaking point. Why did we have to kill Alice? This is a fight that forever changes Travis' touchdown. Margaret and Vladimir may have started to raise Travis's awareness of his brutal lifestyle, but it is Alice's death that ultimately makes Travis realize the brutality of his life, as well as the brutality of the UAA.
We humans are alive, even if we are assassins.
So ultimately, Alice's personality, the awesome battle with her, and the symbolic impact of this fight all mix together to make the greatest boss fight in the series. Not only that, but it makes her a much better potential final boss than this little prick! I'm the Autarch of Flame, and I hate Jasper Bat Jr.
Hey! We're not done yet!